fuel prices have hit new highs in Tanzania as tensions in Eastern Europe continue to hurt the global oil market. We by now know that this is not only happening to Ugandans, but surely business people should brace for tougher times ahead as Russia's invasion on Ukraine continues. Welcome to the Business Show. Here now are some of the stories that made the Business Week. Bank of Uganda warns Ugandans against the use of cryptos. Uganda's economy not producing quality jobs, according to new report. Tropical Bank loses on 18 billion shillings impairment cost. Umeme government engage over connection fees. And KCB opens new unit in Rwanda after merger. Welcome to the show. Now, since 2020, the annual Manufacturers Trade Fair has been on hold due to COVID-19 pandemic. The trade fair is a platform that allows local, regional and international businesses to meet, merge and connect for opportunities for possible buyers and customers. But as the resumption of the 2022 Expo is announced, we seek to find out what will be unique this year. We speak to an official from Uganda Manufacturers Association. Views from the top. Are there things that you need, you believe Uganda should show more to the world that are being done here at home than some of the things we are selling about Uganda?
Speaking of the Dubai Expo, I think for me is to highlight a global level of competitiveness. We have to be honest with ourselves and know that at the moment, there could be areas where the global corporations with massive cost of production reductions and sometimes even incentives from government are more competitive in some areas. We are not going to export Coca-Cola to the US, for example. We are not going to be competitive in France on milk, especially when you factor in the subsidies they give to their farmers. For me, the opportunity is really not in Dubai, but the opportunity is largely around the African continental free trade area. Because as a continent, it is shameful that over 80% of our consumption comes from outside the continent. And for me, that's where the opportunity is. And to your question, my answer would be that the showcase must be on the value chains we are developing, where we can access markets such as the DRC, which is right next door, and is importing milk from Belgium, and is importing $820 million or more, or $82 million or more worth of chicken, and we're only exporting $2 to $3 million worth of chicken. These are the opportunities we need to showcase. And to that point, part of what we are working on with our partners is having these opportunities highlighted during the trade fair, having traders from countries such as the DRC, Central African Republic, South Sudan, come in and have direct dealings with our manufacturers so that our products can go to these markets. Because the future is on the African continent. It's not beyond Africa as far as I'm concerned.
All right, Daniel, so you mentioned the fact that Africa is our biggest market is outside Africa, and I will take you back to the African free trade area. The agreement was signed, but there is a bit of sluggishness in taking it up, especially by our Ugandan manufacturers. What do you think is the problem, and how can we utilize that kind of free space?
Perhaps to just put it in context, the agreement, yes, was signed and acceded to by the requisite number of countries, including Uganda. But there are still negotiations ongoing on several of the elements of the Continental Free Trade Area, such as the product offerings from the different countries. What could we do faster is what I will answer. One is that we certainly, as a country, need to conclude our national strategy on access to the African Continental Free Trade Area, because it will guide us on what the role is for the private sector, what the role is for government, and what the role is for development partners in terms of enabling us access some of these opportunities. Number two is that there is need for recognition of what the opportunities are. Where are the opportunities? Because exporting is not a fact of me waking up tomorrow and carrying my sack to the border. It's a fact of engaging and understanding that, look, there's actually a need for this particular product in this country, in these quantities, and these are the procedures involved in getting there. That kind of information is what makes manufacturers confident in accessing the markets that are available to them. The third element would also be around recognizing where we sit. We sit in a region that is prone to violence. Violence, as we see in Eastern DRC, where there's practically multiple small wars ongoing. We are playing a big role in stabilizing the area. But can we also stabilize the trade facilitation environment by providing export guarantee insurance? Because what that does is, as a manufacturer, if I'm taking my product, I'm not worried that if the truck gets hit, I'm going to make a total loss. I know that if the truck gets hit, I'll go to the insurance company and it will pay me for the loss I've incurred. In fact, it also buffers government against the demands that keep coming up to say, look, I lost this and I need you to pay me back. Because that shouldn't be the role of government. And then lastly for me would also be, what are we doing around the soft and hard infrastructure that goes along with access to some of these markets? For the DRC, which is close, do we have border warehousing facilities that mean that my product has competitive advantage by virtue of the fact that it's at the border compared to a product coming in from Kenya? Do we have cold chain facilities at the border that ensure that milk, ghee and butter do not go bad as they are waiting for buyers? Do we have a simplified trade arrangement with the neighboring country that ensures that they don't go through hoops to access our products? To that end, are we even doing more and providing incentives to the likes of Centenary Bank to set up operations in DRC so that if I need money from Kampala, I just go to my local Centenary Bank in Goma and ask them to give me a facility in Kampala? Because that's what our neighbors are doing. That's what Kenya has done. Equity is all over DRC. So that speaks to the strategy. We need a concerted strategy. We need it yesterday, but we will settle for today so that we can easily benefit from the potential benefits of the continental free trade area.
Thank you. A lot of young people have been encouraged to go to find a way to get employed by themselves, start up something. And the president himself has advocated for sciences across the country, which has led to a lot of budding innovations. And head of the trade fair, I would love to know what you think can be done to make sure these innovations see light and actually become something big that will benefit Uganda.
We do recognize the innovations that have come up. Like I said, on our part, we are focusing on the e-mobility innovations. But that's not all we are doing as an association. Within the trade fair, we are in final discussions to have an innovation corner that will then feature some of these innovations from our young people that probably need a little push, a little funding in order to move to the next level. So our appeal is, if you're a young person out there and you feel you have an innovation that can really make a difference, come through. We'll put you as part of a group and you'll be vetted, and if your innovation comes out top, we will certainly provide free space to these young people to showcase some of these items. But even in the absence of that, we are running mentorship schemes as an association, where if you feel, for example, that you're involved in the manufacture of artisanal soaps and you would like to be linked up with the likes of Mukwano around understanding how to scale, we're happy to help and facilitate that process. And this is the case for the different sectors as well. I believe that we need to support these innovations and we need to push them a step further. Maybe finally on that one is, even as we do those things, as an association, we are also cognizant of the skill gap between graduation and what we need. And we have projects in place, one of them which is the Ready to Work project, where we provide a platform for young people fresh out of technical college to have a placement in our manufacturing industries. and to learn what is actually required in the workplace. And at the end of that placement, about 50% of those people get retained. So there are jobs possibly available for you if you reach out, but only if you reach out, because we can't know who is out there and what they are doing.
So Daniel, we had about 2 years of COVID-19 and manufacturers were not able to take part in this very critical experience of the trade fair. So would you say that from what they've told you and the lessons, the time they spent in lockdown, for example, and so many other effects of COVID-19, would you say that they've learned a lesson as manufacturers?
Yes, they've learned the lesson as manufacturers, and this is seen in the changes to their sourcing, because several of them have readjusted their supply chains to source their critical raw materials from Uganda. One key example of that is that, for example, in the beverage sector, there's emerging capacity locally to produce industrial sugar, a key input in the manufacture of beverages and confectionaries, which is a big, big boost because it means we are doing import substitution. Several of them have had to undertake risk analysis and risk mitigation for their enterprises, and as such, they are more resilient today than they were before COVID. Several of them are paying closer attention to the welfare of their employees, and the fact that at the end of the day, you have to keep your human capital satisfied and happy, because they then feed into your production process. And they're the ones who make the sacrifice to come to work every day, even when the situation is quite dangerous or difficult, so that you can move your production. And then, of course, lastly is on market, that at the end of the day, you cannot rely on one single market, but you have to diversify the areas in which you sell your product if you're to survive such a big hit.
So manufacturers doubled their efforts, and you've talked about them learning to do local production, which production I believe, coupled with taking care of their workers, would lead to a very big output. So talk about the consumption in Uganda and our abilities as Ugandans after COVID-19. Have you been able to feel like we have the capacity to consume everything that is being produced at that rate?
Yes and no. Yes, because following the opening up of the opening of the economy earlier this year, we noticed an upswing in consumption, because suddenly a lot of the elements that contribute to the consumption patterns, especially for fast moving consumer goods, were back online. Schools being back online, of course, has a whole big impact it has on quite a number of sectors, among them cereals, among them bread, among them eggs, and so many other, especially food items, as well as stationery and books, which were unable to sell anything over the 2 years of the lockdown. So there was an upswing in consumption for this. However, fast forward to today, of course, the challenge is that with the Ukraine-Russia situation, with the rising demand for critical raw materials across the world, there's suddenly now price inflation on a number of products, a number of our inputs, subsequently feeding into the pricing of some of these products on the market, which is affecting buyers' ability to buy them. At the same time, the salaries or the incomes are not matching the pace of price increment, especially for things like fuel or cooking oil or soap for that matter. And as a result of this, we are seeing now a slowdown in the market. There's a dampening of consumption, there's a dampening of consumer uptake of our products, which is worrying. But we know that some of the factors for these are beyond Uganda. Of course, we keep speaking to government about critical interventions to address this.
Thank you for watching The Business Show. We are taking a break, but still to come is how you and your spouse can actually manage a business successfully.
It is love. You know, take a cent or whatever. Your wife is there. I'm here.
That's right.
We are working together. Yeah. Mm. That's together. That's continuation of love. What people, actually, you're laughing, but that's a very good point.
Yes.
Most of the people, you find the wife is working in Kabong or Abim. Mm. The man is working in Mbarara. They spend the whole month, the whole year, and they call it marriage. That's not marriage. Okay, that's not marriage. Marriage is when you're seated looking at your wife.